My name is Manjeet Kaur.
And my name is Gurnam Singh.
Welcome to the One Show.
Waheguru Ji Ka Khalsa,
Waheguru Ji Ki Fateh.
In today's show, we're going to be discussing Sikh representation, particularly in Parliament, but in other institutions as well. And we've got a fantastic array of guests, which I'll introduce to you afterwards. But just before that, Manjeet, there's been some very important events this week and to celebrate. And we're just going to just briefly mention those. The first one was in Derby, you know, the Sikh Museum. If you can see the image behind, you'll see that the Home Secretary, Theresa May, paid a visit to the National Sikh Museum in Derby today.
What was she doing there?
Well, actually, it was on Wednesday, not today.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it was part of the museum's event for the commemoration of the 100 years since the First World War. And she unveiled a plaque, to commemorate the Sikh soldiers. And that was a really fantastic event. And of course, the second one, which is again phenomenal, and actually that was this afternoon that this event took place. And again, there's an 8-foot bronze statue of the decorated officer, the late squadron leader Mahinder Singh Bhuji, which was unveiled in Gravesend today.
And
I mean, it makes you feel
proud. That's fantastic. I feel so proud, to be honest.
Yeah, and you know, again, it's not only commemorates the Sikh contribution in all conflicts, actually, it's from 1914 to 2014. And the amazing thing about this statue that you can see, it was sculpted by a very famous British sculptor called Douglas Jennings. And it was unveiled by Air Vice Marshal Edward Stringer today. So this is, again, a really fantastic event, yeah.
Should we introduce our guests?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Let's go and introduce our guests. So let's start from my right-hand side. I'd just like to start with welcoming Pyara Singh Bogle, a regular on our show. And Pyara Singh, as well as representing Sikh Council UK, is also leading light in the Birmingham Gurdwara Council as well. Next to Pyara Singh, we have Jagjit Singh from the Sikh Council UK. And next to Jagjit Singh, we have Gurinder Singh Joshan. All today's guests are from the Sikh Council UK. So, we will be exploring, as I say, some of those things. So if I turn to my left, on the first we have Bhai Gurmail Singh Kandola, who, as you will know, is the re-elected General Secretary of the Sikh Council UK. So congratulations to Gurmail. I don't know if it's commiserations or congratulations, but you can let us know afterwards.
It's an honour.
Yeah. And next to Gurmail is Belvinder Kaur, who manages the office of the Sikh Council UK. It's probably the only paid member of the Sikh Council, but that's... And next to her is Jagtar Singh, I think. Jagtar Singh is involved in many different aspects, and we will learn more about that today. So, Sare mein Viranu Ben, Jinnu Sare no mein, welcome Karda Sa Fateh Bilaiya Ji, Waheguru Ji Ka Khalsa,
Waheguru
Ji Ki Fateh.
Before we go on to our main point, would you like to share your opinions, views about the two events in Derby Museum and the...
The statue in Gravesend,
Gurmail, I know that you've been involved in the Derby Museum. So tell us a bit about that.
Yeah, I think both of these events have been very positive for the Sikhs, because in a way what's happened is it's mainstreaming the Sikh contribution, historically to the British Army. And I think through these two events, what has happened is the mainstream media has picked it up. Mm-hmm. And hopefully people will now remember a bit more that these turban-wearing Sikhs, what they have contributed. And more importantly, when we are having discussions about the right to wear the dastar in workplaces, in the armed forces, I'm hoping that people will remember that these are the very people and the scale of sacrifice that they have historically made.
I mean, Bhaji, I don't know, again, we were talking about how proud it makes us feel when we see these things, and it's taken a long time, but eventually that story is now being told. What kind of impact does it have?
It really does have a big impact. One of the things I noticed over the last few weeks, particularly in the period of the commemorations, is they've been showing different communities who have been involved in World War One, but the distinction that Sikhs have within that and the level of contribution, it's unarguable, isn't it? It's so. And the moment was proud. We were quite proud when the Theresa May, the Home Minister, did actually come to the event, because she also acknowledged it in absolutely amazing words.
What did she say? Because you guys were there. Yeah. What kind of? What did she say?
She absolutely really valued the contribution in thousands that the Sikhs had made, and also the conditions they would have had to endure, because the conditions weren't good, you know, the trenches were awful. And so she took all of that on board, and she actually was speaking very highly of the community.
I think also she sort of recognised the fact that sort of the Sikhs and the Indian soldiers, and in Britain, that sort of that role had been forgotten over time, and so it's nice to for that to now have come back to the fore again, and to recognise all the sacrifices that were made, not just in the Indian subcontinent, but also in Europe. And on the day when Theresa May unveiled the plaque, she also unveiled two statues as well. Mm. And there's one where a Sikh soldier is carrying a child, a Belgian child. So that was very sort of pertinent. And then she sort of you can see from her face that, you know, she sort of recognised the contribution Sikhs have made. And as Gurmil has said, also the issues we face here with Ardastar, this can only help that.
It's all connected.
It's all connected. So then it's not just because we are saying we need the Gurdwara to be protected, but there's a reason, and it goes back in history over many decades and hundreds of years.
Mm. Gurinder, we talked about impact, and I don't know if you saw, a few weeks ago we had the program here when we were talking about both the Dalvi Museum, but also the amazing exhibition that's taken place in SOAS, the Punjab Heritage Association. And there were some statistics that they'd actually revealed, and they said that before the exhibition, they did a survey, like a kind of a poll, a street survey, and they found that less than, I think it was around 5% of the population actually that were polled knew anything about the Sikh contribution in World War One. Mm. But subsequent to the exhibition, they did another, and they said that something like 30% of the people they polled said, yeah, now we know about Sikhs, yeah? So that's a phenomenal impact, isn't it?
It absolutely is, and I think that's the key thing here, is the awareness that we're raising of Sikhs and their contribution to the UK and to world history, it really makes a difference. But you know, the other side to that is that the Sikh community has been established in this country for several decades now, but we're at a stage now where the community collectively is confident enough, but also has the skills and the knowledge and the wherewithal to actually go about and do these things. Because all these things, whether it's the statue, whether it's the museum, whether it's the events in, you know, which are taking place in the European Parliament, in Parliament here on Sunday in Wolverhampton, you know, these are all events that are being put on by UK Sikhs, and we're seeing within that sphere, we're seeing younger professional Sikhs coming through who are taking over and running some of those and doing them in a very different way and having a bigger impact than before.
I think you're right, and Jagjit Singh, I think Gurinder's made a really important point about confidence, and maybe if I can reframe that, and it seems to me that, I mean, the Sikh presence has been here for many years, and the Sikhs have been being feted by politicians and, you know, in Parliament and other things, but often it's been a colonial relationship. You know, we've gone there to be grateful to them for giving us crumbs. And it seems to me that there's a shift now. It's almost this new generation saying, we will not reproduce those colonial relationships. We will demand our place at the table and our rights and dignity. Do you think there is a sea change now, as Gurinder's pointing out?
Yeah, I think there may well be. But one of the things I wanted to mention, you know, following on from some of the points that have been raised, I think it's really useful to have a positive story as well about Sikhs. Sometimes we get, you know, we get a lot of negativity, or the star of the Kakar are seen in a negative light. So when we have a story about contribution, and that symbol is that the star, but it's a good contribution to not just Sikhs, but, you know, the wider community. So I think that's really important that we have those positive stories, but also positive role models coming. So this statue, these, you know, sort of unveiling of memories, I think is a really good thing. I think it stands us in good stead for the future.
Yeah. Dr. Paul, again, we're kind of, you know, talking about the importance of memory. You know, why is it important to remember? Why is it for our generation, Sadi Bachi, and, you know, why is memory important?
I think memory is most important because we live with the memories and we leave the memories behind. At the point in the Sikh history, the Sikhs were made to look with a better or a worse image. Now, it's time for us to show the real image of Sikhs. The Sikhs who are truthful, who love the nature, who actually trust other people. And by that trust, they volunteered themselves. They weren't paid soldiers at that time, but they volunteered from India, basically. They came from Punjab to protect. And they didn't know what they were letting themselves into. Mm-hmm. But they came here, and we are proud. We are proud to be British Sikhs. And and that is important for our identification, so that we can stand out of the crowd.
Well, that's a really important point, and we will be talking about how the Sikh Council UK itself is you know, it's very much a UK organisation, you know, and even your logo now is adorned with the Union Jack. But there are some tensions here as well, because, I mean, if you take like the Saraguri, for example.
Yeah.
The Indian state has never officially commemorated. To this day, there's a Gurdwara Saraguri, but the Indian state itself hasn't. And therein lies the tension, doesn't it? Because, you know, whilst the Sikhs were fighting for the British, defending the British, there was also, as it were, India fighting for its independence. But there seems to be some thawing of that relationship. I was in at the London Assembly Building, again, about 2 weeks ago, where the Deputy High Commissioner of India actually made a speech, and it was to commemorate the First World War. So they themselves now are beginning, maybe it's because they're trying to build positive relationships with the West. So do you think this is a great opportunity, Gurmeel, now to remove some of those, blockages as well?
No, absolutely. And I think the thing here is not to rely on anybody else. Mm. The Sikhs have to organize themselves and tell their own story. Mm. And what I'm finding is that's exactly what's happening. I mean, there's a young lad called Jay Sohal. Mm. He's been campaigning and he's put together a fair bit of resource for a National Sikh Memorial at the Arboretum. Mm. And you mentioned about the Punjab Heritage Trust, there's the Anglo-Sikh Heritage Trail, there's a Derby Sikh Museum. There is the group that, I think it was the Anglo-Sikh Heritage Trail who trained those young men to march. Mm. And the event they had the centre. Now, all this is happening through self-help. Now, if we were relying, for example, on the Indian state to be celebrating the Sikh contribution to World War One, I think we might be waiting a long time.
Yeah.
It may happen in India, but in UK, I think we are now strong enough, confident enough, and you know, we can do it.
And Jagdal Singh, I mean, you guys in Leamington a few years ago, you know, you created Shawl, the Leamington and Warwick Sikh Heritage Association.
You were involved.
And I can remember, because we were all involved in that it had a phenomenal impact on the youth.
Well,
the British born youth, and it's all, you know, it actually works, doesn't it?
Yeah. I mean, to be honest, many weren't aware of exactly what the contribution was, and many weren't aware, that so many Sikhs had gave up their lives, and were in important battles, and the Battle of Saraguri. Most people weren't aware, and we had a session once at a local venue where that battle was, you know, and there were tears in people's eyes when they heard about that battle, and the sacrifices of those Sikhs that died at the Saraguri battle. So you know, it's education. It's really important, and it improves awareness, and more people know about it, and then you have the confidence about yourself, and especially for the younger generation, you know, made it even prouder to be Sikhs. You know, we had the new Gurdwara built at the time, and all these programs were happening, and it gives that inspiration, you know, as to who you are, especially the younger generation, who is not their fault they haven't been told or informed, but once they do find out, and then it makes them, you know, better Sikhs.
I mean, Pavinda, we live in a media age now. And if we're not, you know, have a presence in media, then we're finished.
Mm-hmm.
The recent Jal Sarjada movie, it has had a phenomenal impact. In fact, we're talking about our story.
Yeah.
Here's another amazing story that's been lost to the people of Punjab, of India, the Sikhs of India.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems to be just having a wave of not only emotion, but kind of like pride.
Mm-hmm.
We're only at the tip of the iceberg. Yeah.
No, very much so. It's very illustrative, and it appeals to all audiences, and I think you're absolutely right. In fact, I've watched it twice because of the impact it had, and I wanted to be on the journey again with somebody else to say, watch this, watch what happens, kind of thing. And really the impact it's had, and I think that sense of pride, going back to your query about why is it important to preserve our history, is about the generations to come, and that's telling story of so many hundreds of years, and yet even our kids felt as if it was just happening here and now, when they related to it, and that's why the memorials and all of the...
Sorry, what made you watch it again?
the impact it had. And it actually, I got to learn a lot.
Yeah.
You know, I definitely got to learn a lot. And I also, like I said, I wanted other people to be part of that journey. So when they says we want to go, I'll come with you again. Because I really, the impact it has, and it brings it home, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. So I think that, including like we're talking about the memorials and other memory commemorations we're doing, I think it's a story to tell for generations to come.
Grinder, you know, there are always two sides to a story, isn't there? And, you know, nationalists and people who maybe are extremists and fundamentalists also tell their stories, but they often tell a very partial story. Is it important that we see all sides when we look at history? Or should we just simply glorify, you know, or just take one version? You know, I don't know. It's a bit more tricky question, but it's the impact, you know, because otherwise we might just become emotional and kind of, you know, we can get drawn down the kind of the wrong path.
Yeah, I think you have to remember that any event is going to be different through whoever eyes you look at it through. The one thing that is a real constant for us, though, is that the Guru's history, you know, that's a very real constant, and that story needs to be told, in, you know, like the child said, by the film, in different media, in different ways, so that we're educating future generations.
Some people are critical of that. Some people are saying, "Tusi, sahabiyan de mazak kara tha, tusi cartoon." Because in the past, why we haven't been able to tell our story of the Gurus is because we were not allowed to, as it were, depict the Gurus.
That's right. And even in that animation, Guru Gobind Singh Ji, every time he's shown a stationary, not animated.
But what's wrong with an animation of Guru Gobind Singh?
I think this is a discussion for the wider band to have. And is there a time when we say, well, actually, we need to move beyond some of those previous fixed points?
Well, maybe our viewers, you know, do you have an opinion? Do we should we take the Jar Sahib Jadha move as a way now to tell the whole story of all the Gurus in animated form? You know, because I'm just thinking about if we began to tell the story of Guru Nanak Dev Ji and the Chhad Adasiya, Pogal Sahib.
I was just going to point out,
it would be amazing.
You know, a lot of people, like, you know, people have watched it and they said, oh, it's fantastic, it's this and that. But are they going to apply it to their life? Now, this question has been asked, the message behind it.
Is it just
go watch,
wipe your tears away and go home?
No, I think it is important, but we are about 50 to 60 years late. Mm-hmm. We should have done that kind of movies about 60 years ago, so that our youngsters can link to it. Mm-hmm. It's that link which is breaking. Mm-hmm. We want to pass the information on, but we can't do it. And through animation, I think we hit it right the nail on the head itself, and I think it will have impact on the youngsters. You take a young 9-year-old and they can actually relate to what's going on, which is important. I know,
but the irony is, you know, it took 3 years for the SGPC to get permission for that movie.
This is what it is. They are so conservative way of looking at things, that they're not trying to use the media and what we got on our hands.
Yeah.
And if you do that, I think we will go a long way. If you ask any youngsters coming to watch after Char Savjay, they will tell you what they learned. They haven't learned that in all their lifetimes.
Okay, you're watching The One Show, and today we've got some very special guests from around the UK. Everyone is involved with the Sikh Council UK, and today's topic is very much around you know, the projecting of the Sikh image in the mainstream, but more crucially, representing Sikhs. How do we get the Sikh voice into the you know, the corridors of power? And you know, we'll now start to, maybe we can move on now to talk a bit more about the Sikh Council. Okay. Gurmeet Singh, you know, recently on the 11th of October 2014, you know, you were re-elected or re-nominated, or call it what you want, as the General Secretary of the Sikh Council UK. So this is your third year, and in fact it was the third General Assembly of the Sikh Council UK. So I think first of all I'd just like to congratulate you guys on a magnificent achievement, because it can't be that easy establishing from scratch.
It's not an easy job.
Such a significant body, you know. So, you know, what is the mission? You know, where did it begin? Give us some.
Yeah, I think firstly, can I just say that although I have been sort of, you know, I feel very honoured that I've been asked to serve the third term, but all the Sikh Council's achievements are a part of a collective, and the people you see here have made enormous contribution to it. You know, I'm just the chief administrator of this team, if you like. Yeah.
I thought you were the
secretary general. No, I'm not.
No, I was thinking about the midwife. You know.
What's that about?
No, I think
you're right.
You've been looking after it for the last 3 years.
I think we were blessed with the opportunity by the punt for this child to be born and then to nurture it. And we're still in the nurturing stage.
Yeah.
Now the question is, okay, why what was the need for it? And people have often said to me, hold with the table. I think the concept that was born came out of a meeting that was held at the Ramgarhia Gurdwara on Graham Street, very historical meeting, where a huge body of Sikh organizations, Gurdwara representatives turned up, and they collectively felt that there was a case for having a representative body of the Sikhs, which is democratically constituted.
I mean, how historic was that gathering in terms of global Sikh? Where would it go in history, that gathering?
My sense is it is something that would be recorded in history, because that was the first time in UK what you got is a democratic mandate for something to come into being. Not a gathering of a few people, but a gathering of the Panth, essentially. You see, this is Walpuchana, it's a really good question. It's been asked historically by people like, you know, Plato and Aristotle and so on, who's got the right of representation? Mm-hmm. I thought a sual really, I have to say, it's a sual that we need to ask. Mm-hmm. You see, representation comes in various ways. When Sikhandi representation is given, Gurdwara the elected committee, who represents the Sangat. If Gurdwara then put people forward to come to the General Assembly of the Sikh Council, it becomes a representative body of those Gurdwaras or of the Panths, doesn't it? And if they then select people to serve them, then you have the right of representation. And I think Sikh Council historically is the first time in UK, after a very long time, long struggles, you now got a democratic body with a mandate to represent. Mm-hmm. And with the mandate comes accountability.
Yeah.
And do you think this is why then that the British government themselves were very keen to work with the Sikh Council, because they saw this as a mandated organisation?
I think so. I think, I mean, there are lots of good Sikh organisations, you know, doing a phenomenal amount of work, and I mentioned a few earlier on. There are others, Khalsa Aid, SOPW, Sikh Federation UK, fantastic job. But what the government also saw, what this was now, a collective body, democratically constituted, with a mandate to represent. And that is significant. Okay, accountability is idea. I can't make a statement and not be accountable. My colleagues say collectively will decide Sikh Council policy gear, and then we're accountable for it. You know.
But really, you've been involved from the beginning as well. In fact, in many ways, you've seen it from the inside out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, how do you? You know, what's your kind of a take on this in terms of both history, but also the achievements as well?
The achievements. It's built momentum. As it started off, there was a bit of a, you know, do we need it for a start off? And secondly, is it going to do well? Is it going to be? So there's always, and like, we've only just been...
Trick pony, maybe it's going to last few months, and then you ask you Larpana.
Which we do.
Have there been moments where it's been on a knife edge?
You can't answer that question.
Marriage grip has never been on. Marriage grip has never been on knife edge. I think we always come to a point of a healthy medium, and it's being able to deal with robust discussions.
Yeah.
And that's the secret. It's about that robust discussion and being able to see the bigger picture. And I think Sikh Council, that's why it's built its momentum. I think it's always been able to see where we're going and then the steps we need to take to get there.
Well,
and
I was going to ask you, Tanti, how do you cope in the men's world? Like, how many, is there any
I'm honoured to have so many brothers. They're amazing.
That's a different magic. But I'm sure you would like to have more sisters.
Oh, absolutely. And marriage group, like I said, because of the momentum it's picking up, we're actually increasing in women representation. And ironically, a lot of Ravindas.
Yeah.
So we've got three, so something.
You want to become the next general section, make sure your name is coming
through. I think you're a very strong woman.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thing. Again, I think Leamington's had a very pivotal role in inspiring, and if not inspiring, actually also working with the Sikh. Not only was Leamington where we held the first General Assembly, but in some senses it was the momentum that we created in Leamington of something new.
Yeah.
that itself, I think, can inspire the Sikh Council.
Yes, I think, at the time, the Gurdwara, when, you know, Maradi Kirpat, the Gurdwara was built. And at the same time, the Sikh Council was being formed. And the very first meeting was in Leamington Gurdwara. And to be honest, Leamington, I'm proud to say, is very, has a good say within Sikh Council. You know, there are many member organisations, individuals, very capable, who are working closely with Sikh Council. I just want to touch on a couple of points that Gurmeel Singh made. Sikh Council, if you go back a few years, when there were big issues to do with Sikhs, and there were various organisations that dealt with those issues, what was needed was an organisation, any serious issue that concerned Sikhs throughout the UK, where that organisation would act on behalf of all Sikhs. And that's, you know, Sikh Council's premier role is that, is to act when there are issues to do with, you know, the start or issue when 1984, it was the Sikh Council that was at the fore. And I think it's important, and government has realised that. Theresa May, this wasn't the first time she came to a Sikh Council event. In one of our General Assemblies she attended, and she referred to the Sikh Council as a premier, the Sikh premier organisation, where they're willing to do work with and to engage with.
Mentioned in Parliament as well.
On the caste issue, on the Dastar issue to do with the hard hats, and Gurinder Jagjit Singh worked, you know, tirelessly in that respect. So and we're pragmatic, and you know we try to take the emotion out of the issue, but to deal with the issue, to find a solution for the issue, and that's important, and that shows that we are growing and more confident about our community, and I think that and more of that's required. And I think when it comes to government, they do want a pragmatic approach, and sometimes to take the emotion, leave the emotion behind, even though it's important. The emotion's important when you're having dialogue, being pragmatic, being professional. Yeah. All that's very important.
Yeah. I mean, Jagjit, is that the key thing there, that the government is prepared to do a business, as it were, with people who they know are representative, and B, can actually act in a professional way? And is that being key to the kind of success?
I think so. I think the professionalism and also the inclusivity, you spoke about women. There are more Sikh representative women in the Sikh Council than probably all the other organisations put together. That's not a slight at them, it's just, when you have a lot of women, we've got a lot to do, but it's it's a leaps and bounds on what existed previously. But the one thing I wanted to mention was, when you spoke about the past and the history and the need for the Council, I think the existence of the Council shows the maturity of our community now. I don't think this would have been possible 10 years ago. I think yourself, Gurnam Singh, you were involved as part of the need for a council. Some of the other senior leaders at the point who were involved were looking very much to the future. They've done their 30 years. They're looking to the future now and establishing something for the next generation. And the government needs it, and I think us as a community, we need it as well. When we talk about legitimacy and accountability with representation, some of the things that we get consistently called to do now, whenever there's an issue in the community, people are looking for the council to see what is your view, or what's the collective view. So I think there was a need in the community, and also a need externally with the government as well. That's why it's been very successful.
Gurinder, I mean, the iron's very hot at the moment, isn't it? Both because we've had the 30th anniversary and the papers that came out, and of course the general presence, but also because mainstream politics now is seen to be, there's a massive kind of shift. We might have the Scottish nationalists who might have whole balance of power. It's almost as if there's a golden age of minor parties, and we're moving towards de facto a kind of proportional representation. And in that system, everybody's vote counts, isn't it? Because, it's kind of cumulative. And, is this a golden moment now for the Sikhs to really kind of, get their influence on power?
I think it is, and I think it's not just for those reasons. I think there's more reasons as well. I think one of the biggest things is that we're, the community is now able to make better use of some of those opportunities, and also engage in those structures in the way that we should be engaging, which maybe 5 years ago, 10 years ago, we didn't. So, caste legislation came about, we very quickly, we employed lobbyists, we lobbied ministers, we had meetings, we go to dinners, we do all kinds of things to try try and build that influence. And a lot of it is about building influence, and that is done in different ways. And I think, you know, the Sikh community in this country is uniquely placed in that. We're a very successful community in every way. The only thing we don't engage in politics, but it's there for the taking. And if our youngsters, if our community were to actively get engaged, not just in politics, but in every field, you know, school governors, magistrates, you know, the whole thing.
The viewers will know that we've now got a text messaging facility as well, so, and I'm already getting text messages coming through, so I'm going to just throw one, people are throwing some questions, if I could just throw them into the pot and then people can pick them up. First one was, somebody said, again, just reiterating on the women question, you know, you said that women are involved. What's the kind of, you know, in terms of, say, the executive, yeah, the general, how many women have we got, is it about 52 all over in general? How many women have we got in the general?
We've got four women on the General Assembly.
Mm-hmm. Out of how many?
Out of 51.
So that is, that's still a long way to go. Yeah?
Long way to go, but these are on the executive committee, sorry. And,
what about women's organisation?
Two of them are chairs of committees.
Okay.
So the Community Safety Committee is Balwinder Kaur Sandhu, and the European Affairs Committee is Paramjit Kaur Mathalu.
The other question that's come in is about youth, whether youth organisations, I don't know if you know, because we have quite a lot of youth organised, Sikh youth organisations, we know the Gurdwaras, but what about the youth organisations, are they actively involved?
There are one or two youth organisations on board, there are also youth that, as the demographics change, there are some youth coming through in the Gurdwara structures now, and more so, you know, in the coming years. So through the, you know, the traditional organisations as well, through Jathe Mantia, a number of youth are very actively engaged. Well, I think I would consider myself youth, maybe.
Well, actually, we're all not one, really. We never stop being youth.
Ganasi, can I just add to that one? One of the things we have done is that we are now developing a youth subcommittee.
Oh,
and that's largely focusing on youth engagement.
Oh, that's fantastic.
When I say engagement, that's in a sense they're already actively engaged in panthic work.
Yeah.
And we feel it's really important for them to have a seat at the table. And our job is that in future discussions and so on that take place, say, for example, with government, I always want to make sure that there is some youth representation on that table.
And when the cabinet papers came out, I think youth were quite heavily involved at that time, weren't they? In meetings with Banaswasi and other things.
Yes, took them with us.
There were, and to be honest, it was important, because it was important that they were there to see how the matter was being handled. Because sometimes with youth there's also scepticism that, you know, how are the band, how are they managing, talking and debating the issue. So it's important, and they were part of it. And there were some really good suggestions, and the government did take some of them on board, especially referring to, rather than saying Golden Temple, referring to Haram Sita and Amritsar.
There was another phone, Ranjit, they asked about major events, and we went to that Leicester event, and in fact, the Carl Channel covered that, which, if you remember, was a fantastic event, a great gathering. And that was organised by Sikh Council. I mean, just because the viewers are asking, what recent events have we done that are significant? Just maybe just share that one.
I think the most recent one is the one in Leicester. Yeah. We did that in partnership with the Leicester Sikh Alliance. And this is where Harjinder Singh from Sikri was there.
Harinder Singh,
I beg your pardon. And that event was targeted mainly at the non-Sikhs. And we were very successful in actually attracting quite a few people there. So once again, they heard the Sikh perspective to some of the modern events.
So what was really amazing about that event was that we had, MPs there, we had academics there, we had senior Sikh officers, and we also had members of other communities.
Mm. And so we had a mixture.
They did raise some of these Shakwini, in fact, the Narankari kind of thing was raised.
It was, yeah.
And rather than, usually what we do is, we shout, either we get shouted down or we shout. Harinder gave such an impressive response that even the person asking the question had to take back that.
That's right.
So that's the kind of way forward, isn't it? Dialogue, informed dialogue.
We've said all the good stuff. What problems do we face?
I don't know. Come on, let's be honest now. Yeah. It's not all.
I think one of the problems that we face, and Sikh Council, has been going for, this is our third term, and even we face that problem, which is that we lack, Sikhs lack infrastructure. You know, seva is fantastic, and we all do it from the heart. But there's a limit to seva. And it's the future phrase for us and for the Sikh Council as well. How do we develop a proper infrastructure where we have offices, we have staff, and where when
we... What's the infrastructure at the moment then? Is that too much a grand term to talk about a rooming?
No. I think that's a very fair question. At the moment, the infrastructure is, just for clarity's sake, Govinda Court, on a part-time basis, this is the paid part of it, and it's a very nominal amount, looks after the work of the Sikh Council. And that is the sum total of it. And everything else that you see around here is done on a voluntary basis. Yeah, and we have a PO box address. And so our aspiration is to actually have a proper office, have it properly staffed, so that people like myself, Gurinder Singh, Jagjit and so on, don't have to keep on taking annual leave to attend meetings in central London. And
you did have a parliamentary
worker, we did, yeah.
And that was very effective. I know that was time, it was limited.
It was, yeah. Once again, we had, in fact, Jagtar Singh was instrumental in collecting resources for that. And when the resources disappeared, I mean, the post had to go, essentially. But the post was actually effective in meeting some of our objectives to build influence and those political
projects. I mean, it did open up doors, didn't it?
It did.
I mean, I myself was at one meeting in Paul Cullis House, where we had some very senior Conservative politicians there. So, you know, it is about getting people in Parliament, in the corridors of power as well, isn't it? You know, what kind of strategies have we got to do that? You know, both elected MPs, but also in other ways as well.
It's about getting people everywhere, not just into Westminster. What I alluded to earlier, it's about building influence, and it's about our community getting engaged everywhere. The issue about lack of political representation, so, you know, there's only one Sikh MP, Paul Lepore, there's two Sikh lords now, but in terms of the numbers of Sikhs in this country, and our representation is terrible. Even at councillor level, there's only about 100-odd councillors, Sikh councillors up and down the country. So, you know, we need to do better at all those things. But we also need to do better in the back rooms as well. So we're, and there are some people in the two main political parties who are working in the back room, who are Sikhs.
I'm just wondering. I'm getting quite a lot of messages saying there's not much evidence of youth engagement, and I'm just wondering whether there might be some ideas. Because you might want to come in there. I mean, it's not just a problem for Sikh Council. Let's be honest. This is a challenge for all mainstream Sikh organisations. How do we involve the youth? Should we have some kind of youth Sikh council?
Should we do that? I think it was already mentioned at our first executive meeting that we was going to have a youth wing type of thing where they're going to be coming and sitting on the table, and the invitations will be sent out to the organization, the youth organizations, which will be invited to come along. Obviously, by taking them aboard, that's the only way forward, because we have to start using Hosh rather than Josh, and this is what we are trying to work on, so that we can work sensibly, collectively, with a unity, with across the all ages, youngsters and our professional and of elders who can actually direct us in the right way.
I think it's important to say that we've seen the change. We've seen a paradigm shift where initially when Sikh Council started to set up, you did see representation of Gurdwaras, so people are a little bit cautious. You know, they're going to be elderly or middle-aged people who are going to come together and do some fancy, and we're not going to get involved or included. They've seen that change. They've seen the change, particularly around the disclosure, like you just mentioned. And in this third administration, for the first time ever, actually, it was very enlightening to see the level of different organisations that are very involved. So you can already see...
So that was a really important point, because I was at the meeting, and what was significant is there was a sense of some organisations in the early days falling off, but there seems to be a sheet change now that the organisation, it's almost like you have to be involved. So you've kind of reached a really important kind of point.
It's about building.
This is something coming back to the, because I've worked with young people for a big part of my kind of career. Hana. When we say youth, what age are we talking about? Hana?
Like us?
I know. So I think what we're really talking about here, we're not talking about children, we're talking about young professionals often. Or maybe not professional, but young adults. I think that's the correct terminology. And Ona Devasina, we don't want to do a tokenistic thing. We got a women representative, meaningful engagement. And by that we sincerely mean seat at the table where the discussions are taking place, where the policies are being formulated. In fact, I can say to you that in the last administration, on the Sikh Council's policy and strategy group, I do count Jagjit Singh as a young adult. These were three young adults, I would say, you know, born and brought up in UK, and they're sitting in that forum where it actually matters. Mm. So they were actually instrumental in devising policies of the council.
Gurnam, I just wanted to give an invite really to all those of you who are texting and to say, where are the youth? If they want to get involved, they are more than welcome. If they send their details to Belvinder Kaur, the email address is on the website. There are a number of committees that they can get involved in.
Yeah.
So if they want to, then the door is always open.
But somebody just text me, keep on with a very positive suggestion as to how you might be able to not only capture the youth, but the children. Which is to support the Sikh schools and somebody said that the Walsall Sikh school, for example, how is the Sikh Council UK supporting?
I think if we were to look at you when you were at the last General Assembly, and you said that there was a bit of a sea change. That was the sea change. Nearly all the Sikh schools, if not all the free schools that come on board, they're now part of Sikh Council. So we are working closely with those schools.
Yeah. And there is an issue as well, isn't there, about the food labelling.
About the food labelling.
The issue was that the government is bringing in new regulations which require schools to serve meat. And the Sikh Council worked with the Sikh schools.
Yeah. And the issue came in Slough, wasn't it? Where there was a demand.
And we passed a resolution that Sikh schools or Sikh ethos schools, in these schools, meat should not be served on the basis it is a Sikh institution.
Meat is allowed.
No, meat is allowed, but we don't serve meat in a Gurdwara.
Because the Guru Granth Sahib is in that building.
Yeah, and often it is in those Gurdwara.
So it's consistent with the Mariyada.
This isn't about personal practice, this is about institutional practice.
Yeah.
And no Sikh institution, Gurdwara, or any other institution serves meat in any way. And our schools should be exactly the same, because that is how our schools and our institutions are most inclusive. And that's a key thing for the government, is to make sure that Sikh schools are inclusive, and this is how we demonstrate that they are most inclusive.
I've got a question for Fogel Saad that came in. It's not for you, but I think you're probably best to answer this. Some people are saying, is the Sikh Council there as a speaking for the Gurdwaras, or is it there as a kind of like a platform for the Gurdwaras? Is it like more like a Sarbat Khalsa, where it's a space where we can come together, or does it actually offer leadership to the
I think it offers both. It offers a leadership, and also it gives them a platform to come along and actually get involved, because this is most important. We are have asking them with open arms, come along.
So then Gurmail Singh is our leader then?
Yes.
He is our
leader. No,
let's clear, because it's important.
I think let's talk about this, please, if you don't mind. I just intervene. They have a responsibility which they must discharge. Yeah? And that responsibility, the Gurdwara has a responsibility to contribute to those issues. The way the Gurdwaras are discharging that responsibility is by being part of the Sikh Council and around that table where discussion, debate and consensus is developed. Now, in terms of who's got the leadership, we've got to be really careful. No single individual should ever be given that leadership mantle. Tradition is collective leadership. So although I'm the Secretary General, as I said, I am the head of the administration, if you like, but I'm not the leader of the Sikhs, and I'm not the leader of the Sikh Council.
Basically, you say we work collectively.
This is part of that collective leadership.
Let me ask you another difficult question. It can come in there. Some people are saying that the Sikh Council is simply a front for the Sikh Federation UK. What extent is that right or wrong?
thank you.
It's coming.
I'm glad the person is asking the question, because I think sometimes this is mischief making. Mm. And the reason I say that is Sikh Federation is on the same table as the Kankit Nijata, as all the different Gurdwaras, as the Ramgriya Council. They're all at the same table. So why is Sikh Federation being singled out in this kind of a way? Mm-hmm. Why not recognize Sikh Council as a positive contributor on this collective table? And I think it's actually magnanimous of organizations like Sikh Federation, of the Kankit Nijata, which are large organizations. But what they've done is they've set aside themselves and they sit at this table as a Panthik organization and be part of the collective.
Jagtar Singh, just again, I think many of you viewers won't know about the structure of the Sikh Council. So you know, there are two different kind of parts to it, isn't it? You've got the General Assembly.
Yes.
There's also the Board of Jathedars as well. What is the role, and who's, you know, who's in the board? Just tell us a bit about the Board of Jathedars.
I mean, the Board of Jathedars is part of the Sikh Council, and it's those individuals who have given time and effort to the Panth. And the Panth,
so like a kind of House of Lords, is it?
Something similar.
Yes,
something similar.
Senior house,
have given much
wisdom.
Time and wisdom as well.
So
where they get involved with Sikh Council, obviously they attend the General Assembly, they attend special meetings that we have, and also where there's issues concerning Panthic issues, serious Panthic issues, or issues to do with Gurdwara, we ask them to get involved. So I mean, they serve an important role.
When you say that, isn't that your job, sort of bringing the Gurdwara in?
Yeah, but that sometimes there are sort of sensitive issues, you know, with member organisations.
Some people do come to you. Do you actually solve their problems? Like, do you if they bring something to you as a Sikh Council?
Where
issues?
Yeah, like a helpline.
Do you actually? Deal with the issue, or do you just say, forget it?
There are different parts, though. I mean, there's the casework.
Because people watching may well be thinking, can we take our immigration problems, or can we take our family?
Where there's casework, individual issues to do with Kakar, or to do with anything, then, you know, Blivinder Kaur and others, we deal with it on an individual basis.
Or you can refer them to
refer them to member organisations who are more experienced, more talented to look after those issues. There may be issues, where Gurdwara issues. We don't really get involved in those because we don't get in the internal, issues of Gurdwara, we don't get involved with. But where there's Panthic issues, then either the Board of Jathedars or some element of Sikh Council might get involved.
Let me just comment. There was one issue that that you did a lot of work on, and in fact, at the last General Assembly, the document which was on the mixed marriages, you brought that in, and it was unanimously agreed. And that document itself has actually been the issue has been a source of great conflict for many years. And in fact, that was the reason why I brought it. But also, the debate is continuing. And I don't know who wants to come in there, but tell me about that policy document itself, because I think that's probably one of the first major policy documents where you've actually tried to offer the Gurdwaras a way forward on issues that are creating local conflict. I mean, just how's that been received? I mean, it's been now, 2 or 3 months?
Yeah, I mean, the reason why we got involved in that was because there was conflict taking place up and down the country, and there were some very real differences of opinion within the community of what should be happening. That also, when we and we had member organisations, Gurdwara, etc., and other organisations saying, look, Sikh Council should do something about this. So what we did, we put in place a process where we tried to look at what the What is it that Gurbani says? What is it the Vetmaryada says? Yeah. What is it the Sandeh says? On this issue, and then try and bring that together into a procedure, a process that local Gurdwara could use, which will be acceptable across the board. Yeah.
I mean, just on that one, as I say, the in essence, the document did as it were consolidate the Akal Takht, Hukam Nama, that mixed faith marriages should not be allowed in Gurdwara. Yeah? But that has produced some reaction. I don't know if anyone picked up. I mean, Sonny Hondal wrote a piece that, and Sonny is a very prominent Sikh journalist. He appears on Newsnight and writes The Guide. Very critical, almost suggesting that this was pandering to fundamentalists. And this week in the Huffington Post, Jodie Lancastle wrote a piece called Sacred or Sham Interfaith Marriage in the Sikh Community, in which, it's a balanced article. I think, members of the Sikh Council were also involved in that. But let me just say, in the Sikh Council UK mission, which is on the website, you talk about the underpinning universal values of Sikhi. You talk about, and I'm quoting, respecting religious freedom of all and embracing diversity, in an equal and inclusive manner. So how does that mission sit next to a policy that effectively denies some Sikhs the right to marry in the Gurdwara? Because that's the kind of issue that's been raised.
I'm not sure there is a conflict between the two. The Sikh Council policy isn't something new. It's not an invention of the Sikh Council. It's a restatement. I suppose it's a sort of practical application of the Kal Takht, whatever. You said it's, you know, it's strengthening the Sandesh. It goes back further than that. It's strengthening the Pontik Rath Murada, which clearly states out that the Ananda Karajan ceremony for Sikhs, the issue has been, you know, how do we define a Sikh? And I think the Kal Takht tried to put in a process by saying a Sikh is someone who has saying and quoting their name, but there can be other ways of defining Sikhs. So we've tried to consider various issues, but, you know, come up with a formula. And also, I mean, for those who criticize now, there was a consultation process
Since 2012, which
went on for 2.5 years. So really, you know, all Sikh organizations were invited to have their say, and, you know, there was a clamor for this to be passed a lot sooner than it was. But in terms of your question, I don't think there is a conflict between the Sikh Council's goals and what the policy is.
Okay, Gurmil, I mean, you and I were at the meeting, and it wasn't an easy thing, and there were many mainstream Sikhs who were worried about this, yeah? So how would you alleviate their fears that this might create schisms and...
Yeah, I think it's a difficult issue. But the Sikh Council has been empowered to take those difficult decisions. So this was an issue that was lingering for years, wasn't it? And it was something we had to grapple with. And I think I would like to emphasize that we consulted over 2.5 years, and we sent out 5 consultation invitations. So, you know, it's not something that's been taken lightly. Some confusion is being caused, either deliberately or otherwise. Sikhs are not against inter-ethnic or inter-racial marriages. We've got to be very clear about that. The policy makes no reference to that at all. It simply says that according to the Sikh Rat Maryada, 2 Sikhs can get married and the Anand Karaj ceremony is open to them. Yeah. Now, are we going to start deciding Panthik matters on the internet or people's social websites? We're not. The Panth is going to decide in assemblies like the General Assembly of the Sikh Council, and prior to that all the work will take place. That's how these decisions are going to be made. And I make no apology for that at all. I appreciate that some people are not happy, but on the social media they've been active on internet websites and so on.
Let me just put something that Sonny Hundle actually in that Huffington Post piece, and I'm going to quote, because I think some people suggest that Sonny himself has been putting out some misinformation. I'm sure he can answer for himself, and we'll bring him on one day. But this is quote: if no Gurdwara, and anybody can answer, if no Gurdwara is willing to host the religious ceremony, the couple will undoubtedly feel that the Sikh community has excommunicated them. What are the chances they will now bring up their children as Sikhs? If you have a minority faith, you should be integrating, not turning people away. So this is what Sonny Hundle said in that Huffington Post piece, that we are in effect de facto excommunicating Sikhs who...
I think it would be very sad if an individual took that view. The reason I say that is because actually it is saying, please come, the Anand Karaj ceremony is open to you, provided you're both Sikhs. That's all it is. And what our experience is, and many Gurdwaras will vouch for that, that this is actually not proving to be a huge problem. In other words, people walking away from it. Yeah, and I expect a few will walk away from it.
Well,
the vast majority are not walking away from it.
Are we closing the doors of the Gurdwara and sending people to churches?
Yeah, this is
I think we are actually sending some of the youngsters away. There's no doubt about that. There are certain ceremonies. Obviously, Sandesh came from a Kal Takht. It's a Sandesh. Yeah. It wasn't a hukumnama at that time, and obviously everything seems to be started from Birmingham at that time, 2005 or 2007. That was the reason. But what the Sikh Council has done, they have devised a paperwork which will overcome some of those problems, where we can actually invite them to come in.
So there is a due process that you can follow.
Yes.
Where people can demonstrate
a question, please. Yeah. Yeah. Is it right for people to have 2 religious ceremonies? Is it right for a person to come to the Gurdwara, have Anand Karaj, and then later on go to a mandir to have Havan, or go to the church to have that? You see, that's the kind of things that are actually happening.
I mean, so I think
these are real issues in the community.
But isn't that the kind of puritanism that the liberal-minded Sikhs are saying? This is a kind of a fundamentalist rhetoric. I mean, in fact, 2 ceremonies happened all the time in villages, and, you know, that's kind of...
2 religious ceremonies?
Well,
2 sacred religious ceremonies for 1 wedding? What is the value being put on on a wedding? Tell me. Yeah. What is the value you're putting on?
That's a valid point.
We're talking about the Anandgarh ceremony here. And it's you know, the Anandgarh ceremony, to for its real value, you have to understand what the Anandgarh is about. Now, if you're not a Sikh and you don't believe in Guru Granth Sahib and the basic tenets of Sikhi, you don't believe in the Ten Guru, you don't believe in Kartpur Guru, then you're not going to understand the relevance of Anandgarh. Yeah. Yeah.
So I agree with Gurmeel, what you said.
It is something that we have to, you know, this document, it was designed to solve a very narrow problem. But we know there are other issues as well.
Yeah.
And it's not designed to resolve all of those. Okay. We have built in when we.
This is actually a big issue, and we're not going to be able to finish this. So I think the viewers have heard that we will come back to this issue because I think, as you said, that the policy itself, you're going to review the policy after 12 months, yeah. And maybe at that point we will come back together.
This is guidance, and as Gurinder said, it came about because there was a need. There were Gurdwara that asking if we wanted to follow the Akal Takht Sandesh and have the Anandgarh, how can we do it? Can you formulate a policy where that Anandgarh
can take depersonalizing the issue, because often it became an issue of two parties and two groups.
So and Gurdwara as a member organization were asking for a solution.
I just want to add one
last
thing.
Last point.
I mean, I know this Sandesh was only for overseas. In India, these kind of practices are going on.
They don't care.
So I think the Sikh Council actually was very brave to actually create a paperwork which can actually open the doors and send us in guidance.
Okay. Sorry, Paji, I know you're saying it's the last point, but one of the things is it actually isn't a policy. It's actually guidelines.
They're only guidance.
No, actually, they're not policy. It's not in tablets of stone. It's a guidance because it was a demand.
That's really important to clear. So, can people get the guidance on the website?
Yes, they are.
So, this, just to reiterate, because it's both important for clarity of the year. You know, काफी समय तो काफी conflict हो रही थी गुरुदेव बात तो जिस करके सारी सिखा दी बेचती हैं जैसे कि media दे बेचते हैं six ना लड़ते हैं तो उन्हें मते नजर रखे Sikh Council वाले ने सेवा देती सी भी तुसी एक guidance develop करो जिधर कि गुरुद्वारे फिर वो consistency use कर सकते हैं और उधे वो तुसी इन दे website तो ले सकते हैं तुसी आप पढ़ो तब चारों ता उधे बच बड़ा अच्छा जानी के टांचा देता है अभी तुसी जे जे non Sikh भी आप भी जो Sikh बनना चाहता था उन अनुकी कुछ करना चाहते so I think we will leave that one there because I know that we're going to go on to some other things.
What has been your main achievement?
Other projects in the last year.
I think this is a difficult one because there's so many.
I think the one in particular, I think, is we
dealt with the issue of destitute Punjabis. People who had come here illegally, didn't have the documentation, are ill sometimes, and they want to go back. And I think working with the Home Office on that one and actually getting funding for that.
So what are the kind of statistics? Because you did get funding.
Over 50 people have returned.
Okay.
And remember, this is totally voluntary. Mm-hmm. And vast majority of them are in desperate straits. Yeah. And I think from a humanitarian point of view, I'd like to think that was a good one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think the other areas where clearly we contributed towards the airports, you know, the star searches in the airport. I think the one that I'm particularly pleased about, and Balwinder Kaur dealt with that one, this was in Austria. Mm-hmm. There's a group of Sikhs who are in their prisons and their religious rights were not being observed. They were in a very bad way. One of them had been seriously beaten and burnt, and to organize for him to get treatment, you know, that kind of work.
And of course, in the sense, although it's a SCUK, you have received some kind of recognition in the European...
Yeah, we're constantly working there. So, for example, when this the goods are in Belgium that's been closed, you know, we're trying to see how we can sort of assist them. So I think these are some among some... I think the best one perhaps now, the recent one, is the hard hat one. Mm-hmm. You know, we have been instrumental in getting the legislation changed.
Well, I was going to ask you...
Yeah, and that is significant when an organisation can have that level of influence without protest, without letter writing, through purely diplomatic dialogue.
So, thoda jaha Punjabi ch vi dasso, because you know, there'll be plenty of our views in Punjabi. What's the current situation hard hats? Who can give us a quick rundown on that? Yeah.
UK ਦਾ ਕਾਨੂੰਨ ਜੀ ਪਿਛਲੇ 20-30 ਸਾਲਾਂ ਤੋਂ ਇਦਾਂ ਸੀ ਕਿ ਕੰਸਟਰਕਸ਼ਨ ਸਾਈਟਾਂ ਤੇ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਦਸਤਾਰ ਪਾ ਕੇ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਕੰਮ ਕਰ ਸਕਦੇ ਹੋ, ਕੋਈ ਬੰਦਿਸ਼ ਨਹੀਂ, ਕੋਈ ਟੋਪੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਪਾਉਣੀ ਪੈਣੀ, ਪਰ ਉਹ ਕਾਨੂੰਨ ਸਿਰਫ ਕੰਸਟਰਕਸ਼ਨ ਸਾਈਟ ਦੇ ਦਾਇਰੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਹੀ ਰਹਿ ਗਿਆ। ਸੋ ਪਿਛਲੇ ਦੋ ਢਾਈ ਸਾਲਾਂ ਦੀ ਗੱਲ ਹੈ ਸਮੈਦਿਕ ਤੋਂ ਆਪਣੇ ਗੁਰਸਿੱਖ ਵੀਰ ਸੀ ਅਤੇ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਸਟੀਲ ਫੈਕਟਰੀ ਵਿੱਚ ਕੰਮ ਕਰਦੇ ਸੀ ਅਤੇ ਉੱਥੇ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਛੁੱਟੀ ਦਿੱਤੀ ਸੀ ਕਿ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਜਾਂ ਤਾਂ ਟੋਪੀ ਪਾਓ ਜਾਂ ਫਿਰ ਮਤਲਬ ਦਸਤਾਰ ਲਾਓ ਜਾਂ ਫਿਰ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਤੁਹਾਨੂੰ ਛੁੱਟੀ ਦੇ ਦੇਣੀ ਹੈ ਸੋ ਉਹ ਤੋਂ ਮਸਲਾ ਚੱਲਿਆ ਸੀ ਅਤੇ ਹੁਣ ਜਿੱਥੇ ਤੱਕ ਹੁਣ ਪਹੁੰਚਿਆ ਸਰਕਾਰ ਨੇ ਪਾਰਲੀਮੈਂਟ ਵਿੱਚ ਇੱਕ ਡਰਾਫਟ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਬਿੱਲ ਕਹਿੰਦੇ ਆ ਰੇਡੀ ਰੈਗੂਲੇਸ਼ਨ ਬਿੱਲ ਉਹਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਕਾਨੂੰਨ ਹੁਣ ਪਾਸ ਕਰਨ ਜਾ ਰਹੇ ਆ ਇਸ ਵੇਲੇ ਬਹਿਸ ਹੋ ਰਹੀ ਆ ਪਰ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਉਮੀਦ ਆ ਕਿ ਅਗਾਂਹਲੇ ਇਲੈਕਸ਼ਨ ਤੋਂ ਪਹਿਲਾਂ ਇਹ ਬਿੱਲ ਪਾਸ ਹੋ ਜਾਣਾ ਅਤੇ ਇਹਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਜਿੱਥੇ ਕਿ ਸਿਰਫ ਕੰਸਟਰਕਸ਼ਨ ਸਾਈਟਾਂ 'ਤੇ ਸਿੱਖਾਂ ਲਈ ਖੋਲ੍ਹ ਸੀ ਕਿਤੇ ਉੱਥੇ ਦਸਤਾਰ ਪਾ ਕੇ ਕੋਈ ਬੰਦਿਸ਼ ਨਹੀਂ ਪਰ ਹੁਣ ਤਕਰੀਬਨ ਸਾਰੇ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਕੰਮ ਵਾਲੇ ਦਾਇਰੇ ਆ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਵਿੱਚ ਹੁਣ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਦਸਤਾਰ ਪਾ ਕੇ ਨਾ ਕਿ ਟੋਪੀ ਪਾਉਣੀ ਪੈਣੀ ਆ ਸੋ ਉਹ ਖੁੱਲ੍ਹ ਅਸੀਂ ਆਸ ਰੱਖਦੇ
ਹਾਂ ਸੋ ਜੇ ਕੋਈ ਟ੍ਰਬਲ ਹੋਵੇ ਜੇ ਕਿਸੇ ਨੂੰ ਤਾਂ ਦੇ ਕੈਨ ਕੰਟੈਕਟ ਯੂ ਵਿਦ ਇਟ ਯੈਸ ਯੂ ਕੈਨ ਪ੍ਰੋਵਾਈਡ them with some kind of documentation
absolutely
Gurmil I know that so that's a really important and sometimes it's behind the scenes that the work and it can take a long time and of course you had amazing achievements at the airports as well I mean I recently traveled in Vienna and other places and, there does seem to be a sea change in Italy and other places where you know, they're much more welcome now for Sikhs. Yes, it seems like they're informed. So that was something that was. What about other?
I was going to say, what do you see yourself in 5 years?
In 5 years?
Yeah. Well, I suppose that's about the kind of vision.
The vision, yeah.
Any issues that you feel, or maybe even that. In the pipeline as well, what you're working on?
Yeah, I think at the moment some of this is quite important stuff that is coming through. Yeah. I don't know if you know, sorry. 13th December, there is a new legislation that is called allergens in the food which you declare. This is a very big challenge for our Gurdwara's.
Langradevich.
There is a bar of food guru who has been married. There is a challenge for our caterers. But this is a law from 13th of December. The consulate information is provided. So that is a big issue that's coming through. ਬਾਕੀ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਹੈਗੇ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਆਪਣੇ ਅਫਗਾਨਿਸਤਾਨ ਅਤੇ ਪਾਕਿਸਤਾਨ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਸਿੱਖਾਂ ਦੀ ਹਾਲਾਤ ਹੈਗੀ ਹੈ ਅਗੇਨ ਬਿਹਾਈਂਡ ਦ ਸੀਨਸ ਆਪਣੇ ਗੁਰਵਿੰਦਰ ਸਿੰਘ ਆਪਣੇ ਬਲਵਿੰਦਰ ਕੌਰ ਦੇ ਬੀਨ ਟੋਕਿੰਗ ਟੂ ਦ ਪਾਕਿਸਤਾਨ ਕੌਂਸਲੇਟ ਹੈ ਆਪਣੇ ਬੋਰਡ ਆਫ ਜਥੇਦਾਰੀ ਮੈਂਬਰ ਪਾਕਿਸਤਾਨ ਜਾ ਕੇ ਏਜੰਸੀ ਸੇ ਮਿਲ ਕੇ ਆਏ ਆ ਵੀ ਟੋਕਿੰਗ ਟੂ ਦੀ ਅਫਗਾਨ ਹਿਊਮਨ ਰਾਈਟਸ ਔਰਗਨਾਈਜੇਸ਼ਨਸ ਬਿਕੋਜ਼ ਇਟ ਇਜ਼ ਅ ਡੈਸਪਰੇਟ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੀ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਫਲਾਈਟ ਹੈਗੀ ਹੈ ਯੂ ਨੋ ਵੀ ਕਾਇੰਡ ਆਫ ਵਰਕਿੰਗ ਔਨ ਦੈਟ ਬਟ ਆਈ ਥਿੰਕ ਇਫ ਯੂ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਪੰਜ ਥੋੜੇ ਕੁਐਸਚਨ ਸੀਗੇ ਨਾ ਇਨ ਟਰਮਸ ਆਫ ਵੇਅਰ ਡੂ ਵੀ ਗੋ ਫੋਰਵਰਡ
ਜਸਟ ਬਿਫੋਰ ਦੈਟ ਬਿਕੋਜ਼ ਵੀ ਹੈਵ ਓਨਲੀ ਗਾਟ ਅਬਾਊਟ 7 ਮਿਨਟਸ ਲੈਫਟ ਯਾ and by the way, I've got excellent feedback from the viewers. They feel that this has been a really important conversation and discussion, yeah? And this is really to put an agenda item. Recently, sexual grooming has been a big thing, and it's an unfolding issue. And the Rotherham Inquiry did mention the way in which certain religious leaders themselves were part of the problem, or they were kind of colluding with politicians. And there is a issue, I think, that's going to get bigger and bigger, which is the whole issue of safeguarding young people within our institutions. It happened in the Roman Catholic Church and it's torn the Catholic Church to a sunder. I mean, has the Sikh Council got any plans to develop some kind of safeguarding?
I think this is something that's on the agenda now. The Sadi Community Safety Committee, they're going to look at it. Because Sadi could repeatedly, what we get now is created Granthi, you know, for example, when they get displaced. Either on a misconduct on that could be sexual, could be pathetic, and they leave one Gurdwara and work in another. The Sanway representation on here, okay, what can we do now to make sure people are aware of it.
Yeah.
And of course, one of the things they do is that they often say, I'm from this Jathebandi, and it's really these other Jathebandi. They, in a sense, create divisions in Panth for their own personal.
That's right, yeah. So, we've got supplementary schools, so this issue of child protection or protection of vulnerable people again, is a real issue. The Muslim community, they have now handled it quite well. In our Geneva Madrasa, they brought that kind of procedures in.
And training as well.
And I think for the Sikh community now, Sikh Council needs to work in that area.
Bhagwat Sahib, and you work closely with Ramgiri Gurdwara.
Ji.
I mean, do you have a safeguarding policy?
Yeah, we have. It used to be known as CRB checks.
Yeah.
Now it's DBS. No?
Well, that's not enough because many people come from India.
No.
They might have a criminal record this long, but they're going to have more.
They're going to hide that.
They're going to hide it.
So what we actually try to do, if you bring a Jatha over from, say, India, we actually ask for the history there. We actually get some sort of references from where they're applying from, so that our children can be protected as well, because we are leaving them in their hands to learn
kirtan or gurbani or santhya of any kind.
Gurundar, what about empowering the children? Because if we think about like Esther Anson's like safe line and child line, do we need I know that we have now the Sikh helpline, but you know they struggle. You know, when they get these cases, they go to the leaders, and you know what the leaders say? I don't want to touch this one. Do we need to now work on empowering the young people? Confidential services, you know?
We have, and Sikh helpline is offering his game a lot as well. And you know, we've created conversation between them and you know some of the authorities are dealing with child sexual abuse, etc. And we're hoping that on the back of that, we can really up the community game in terms of how we deal with these things. And I think that there's a big need there. Part of it's about education. Part of it is about enforcement and having systems and processes in place. You know.
Okay.
It isn't just about you know grantees and stuff. Mm-hmm. It is much wider issue than that.
Okay. We are now in our last 5 minutes, so I do want to give everybody a chance to. Do you want to comment
just
on this
issue? Point? Yeah.
Okay. And then we'll
maybe in the next few weeks, maybe in the new year. And Belinda Gorsamdu, who is the chair of the community safety, is actually doing some you know, pioneering work on this issue. So maybe in the new year you would want to have a have a program with her on some of the work that she's you know.
But I think what I would say now is even though if you are watching now, you know, if there is anything in there, the parents need to support your children, because if you don't support them, then you will just make them vulnerable to these kind of rumors. And you should advise children to contact social services. They are bound by law to give you confidential service. And even if they don't intervene, because sometimes evidence isn't enough, just by breaking the silence, and if the people who might be doing the abusing know that they're silent, that in itself will protect them. So, you know, there's no excuse not to do nothing, even if they seek counsel.
But also to be taking precautions and being proactive.
Yeah.
Sensible laga je tus bachiyan nu chhadde hai ya te kol baith jao.
Parents se bahut zimmedari hai je tusi kise bachche nu kirtani kol chhadde ha je kise classan kol. 99.9% sare bilkul theek ya, because it's a very minor. But still,
and, you know, the other big thing here is we don't want to fall into a trap that the Muslim community did for a long time. Is from the Sikh Council perspective, anybody who engages this kind of behaviour has to be identified, has to be
absolutely
dealt with, and has to be shunned.
And the Jathebandis need to show some responsibility. If it's a member of your Jathebandi, then the day that this is forget your Jathebandi, they're not even a Sikh then. So you have no obligation to them.
Right, I just want to ask Gurmeel again.
Yeah, okay.
Where do you want to see yourself in 5 years?
And now we've got 5 minutes for 5 years, so it's
going to be. And mine is going to be 30 seconds
each.
No, 30 seconds. I think the Sikh Council is a governance structure, and we would like to see this governance structure extend to Europe, and hopefully it becomes a global structure. I think that will be quite important for the Sikhs. Okay, we need to be able to govern ourselves at a global level. We are a global community now,
right? Okay.
And that would be our vision.
What would you like to see in 5 years?
Yeah. What would you?
Your vision.
I think I'd support that one.
I would thought you would say that we might have a female Secretary General of the Sikh Council.
Oh, no. We'll leave it to whatever Maharaj keeps, so we'll work with that.
Jigdar, what's your vision for the Sikh Council?
My vision would be that within the UK and Europe, that the Sikh Council is that premier body, but not just because of the civic individuals do, but we can engage on a formal basis with lots of consultations and meetings where, you know, we can send people that work for the Sikh Council. If you look at the Jewish model and other models, you know, you can't do all through Seva. We're going to have to build an infrastructure.
Yeah.
So my passion would be to make sure the Sikh Council has lots of good Sevadars, lots of good members from different organisations and Gurdwaras, but to have an infrastructure which can take it to the next level.
And we should be afraid of professionals.
And we should take on board the professional Sikhs that are working in every industry, in every sector.
Gurinder, 30 seconds.
Just to develop that, and you know, the professionalism we've shown already with the Sikh Council, we need to make sure that influence permeated across the whole world, even as far as institutions in Amritsar are there as well. You know, there's a saying, you know, is the cup half full or half empty? Yeah? I'm an optimist, and I would say it's not quite half, but it is poor.
Yeah.
But it's not quite half. There's a lot more to do.
Yeah.
And it's about that infrastructure. In 5 years' time, we want to be in a place where we have offices, yeah. where we have people employed, where we are in, you know, where we're impacting every sphere of UK life and across the world.
Jagdeo Singh, the butter is half full, yeah?
My vision of the Sikh Council in 5 years, hopefully, is that there'll be, you know, a number of new people on board, not just us, but you know, the things we're working towards now, those goals will be achieved, but then you know, there'll be a new crop in a number of years, and if the Sea Council is still here and those people are representing the community going forward, then I think we would have at least achieved what we're working to now.
Yeah. Piara Singh, I mean, you've been working for many years on, I mean, like the Birmingham Gurdwara Council. You know, this is a dream come true, isn't it?
It is definitely a dream come true.
So share some more dreams then.
I tell you this much, with the Sikh Council, we're going to have good thoughts, good words, and good deeds. That's what we're going to do, and that's the proper seva for the whole of the humanity and Sikhism. That's
yeah, yeah. I mean, we have got another minute. We had that at Oxford University, we had that sort of Badkal Sahib. And in many ways, that also inspired us, didn't it?
It did,
because we are trying to create a mini sort of Badkal Sahib principle.
No, that's right. Well, Gurnam Singh, you know, you've been part of the development of the Sikh Council from its original inception. In fact, you're part of the Constitution Development Committee, weren't you?
That's I thought you were going to say, I'm part of the Constitution.
No, and I think that vision of... because Sarbat Khalsa, I know it's a very specific gathering, but the concept is consensus-based decision-making. And the more as a panth we can move towards ke vichar de naal, udhar de naal, dharna de ke, jidha jo whatever the right, any whatever Punjabi the word best kede hai, we want to get to a position.
Dende de naal.
ਜਿੰਨੀ ਦੇਰ ਤੱਕ ਆਪਾਂ ਨਾ ਸਬਰ ਸ਼ਾਂਤੀ ਦੇ ਨਾਲ ਵਿਚਾਰਾ ਨਾ ਕਰਾਂਗੇ ਨਾ ਆਪਣੇ ਕੋਲ ਦੇਖੋ ਬਹੁਤ ਕੰਪਲੈਕਸ ਇਸ਼ੂਜ਼ ਆ ਰਹੀਆਂ ਰੰਦ ਕੋਨ ਫਰਜ਼ ਕੀਤਾ ਕਿ ਆਪਣੀ ਡਾਇਲੋਗ ਸ਼ੁਰੂ ਹੁੰਦੀ ਹੈਗੀ ਕਿ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਵੀ 84 ਤੋਂ ਲੈ ਕੇ 95 ਤੱਕ ਜੋ ਆਪਣੇ ਨਾਲ ਬੀਤੀ ਹੈ ਨਾ ਇਸ ਦੇ ਗੋਨ ਬੀ ਅ ਰਾਈਟ ਟਾਈਮ ਟੂ ਹੈਵ ਅ ਡਾਇਲੋਗ ਔਨ ਦੈਟ ਯੂ ਨਾ ਐਂਡ ਉਹਦੇ ਵਾਸਤੇ ਇਟਸ ਨਾਟ ਮੇਰਾ ਡਿਸੀਜਨ ਇਟਸ ਨਾਟ ਤੁਹਾਡਾ ਡਿਸੀਜਨ ਇਹ ਪੰਥ ਦਾ ਤੇ ਪੰਥ ਨੂੰ ਕਿੱਦਾਂ ਇਕੱਠੇ ਕਰਕੇ ਆਪਾਂ ਕੰਸੈਂਸਸ ਬਿਲਡ ਕਰਨਾ ਦੈਟਸ ਅ ਚੈਲੰਜ
We've only got 30 seconds left.
It's the unity. I think this is what Gurmeel Singh has said. Unity
we need.
And that is the only way to success.
Absolutely.
We can do it.
Yeah.
We together, we can do it all together.
Well, I know, you're looking at me now, I know it's my birthday tomorrow, so I turn 52 years old. Can you believe that? I feel very old now.
I mean, so happy birthday to Manjeet. Over Qatar Milo Mere Pai, Dumda Dur Karo Nidlai. Unity is everything. Unity and diversity is everything. You know, we all have different views, but if we come together when our interests are common, I think this is what the Sikh Council is about. So I think we've had a really good open discussion today.
Definitely, it was excellent.
So thank you very much for Sari.
Thank you so much.
Until next week, Fateh Bulane,
Waheguru Ji Ka Khalsa. Waheguru Ji Ki Fateh.